What is up, everybody? Welcome to the Live Composing Show. This is Steven Melin, and this is the Video Game Music Alliance. I hope you are doing fabulous today. It has been several weeks since I have hosted one of these, but I'm very thankful for the last 2 weeks. We've had Casey Strange, one of our pro members inside VGMA. He's been hosting them. I'm excited that we have another member, Adam Morton, who will be hosting a Zelda stream in a couple weeks. So I'm really pumped that we now have a lot of involvement from our members. Lots of good things going inside VGMA. So I do hope that you guys are doing really great. First order of business. Check this out. Boom. Spam. Dun, dun, dun. We are now fully... Not that we weren't professional before, but you know what I'm saying. We're fully branded, is what I should say. We are branded, folks. We got the coffee mugs, we got the hoodies in various colors, and I'm very excited about it. So if you are a member, we actually have ways of earning these, and it's super cool. So thought I would show that off. So I'm just rocking it today, very proud. I always love like making physical things because, you know, we work in a world as composers. We work in a world where we make digital things, digital products. And especially if you're like me and you make digital products like education stuff, videos and courses and stuff. It's just nice every once in a while to actually make a physical thing that goes out into the world and, you know, you can drink coffee out of it. It's pretty awesome. So as of right now, these are not publicly available. I kind of like the idea that these are only available for actual members because, I don't know, it kind of keeps it special. It makes it mean something. But anywho, I'm really glad you guys are here today. Marie, we have Ju, Matt, Rokamora, Clinton, and plenty of other folks who need to say hey in the chat because I don't know you by name unless you say hi. I'm really glad you guys are here. Today's going to be a fun day. We're tackling two things at once. Number one... We're going to be doing a live review of a new-to-me library. It's not a new library, but it's from Spitfire Audio. This is the Hans Zimmer Percussion Library. Now, the Hans Zimmer Percussion, historically, I'm not sure how many years ago, maybe 7-ish years ago, Spitfire put out HZ01, which stands for Hans Zimmer 1, and then they did a 2, and then a 3, and then... They combined them all together into this collection called Hans Zimmer Percussion. They updated it, made it all fancy for contact and everything. And so that's what we're going to be using today. Now, even though this particular collection, I can't believe it, it's 5 years old. There is something to be said about certain libraries in the industry that are kind of timeless and represent a certain sound. And there's a reason why it's become a staple in so many composers' toolkits. And in my career, I have been kind of creeping more and more over the last 2 years into trailer music. And one of the core reasons is, you can kind of see in the description of today's video, that over the last couple of years, as you guys know, I write for video games. I write video game soundtracks, custom scores, and I also put together music packs that are selling on places like the Unity Asset Store, Unreal Marketplace, itch.io, Game Dev Market, Humble Bundle, right? These different places that I can package together pre-written music and then sell them on these different marketplaces. Well, with that, you know, that's one way to make a living. But what's interesting is the games that I've been writing soundtracks for have also been commissioning me to write the music for their trailers. And if you know anything about trailer music, it's completely different. It's a very different style. It's usually epic in nature, very grandiose. It's very large. It's extremely dynamic. It's extremely wide in its volume levels. So, for example, the intensity level goes from a 1 all the way up to a 10 at the end. And there's this very clear structure that goes into it. It has a very clear 3-act structure, very much like a Hollywood blockbuster movie. And with that, the more I've gotten into that world, the more I'm realizing, wow, I really enjoy this and I'm good at it. And it really leans into my strengths as a melodic composer, someone who writes very simple music. And not that it's not sophisticated or good music. It just means it's like really, really high production. And the core melodies are very singable and repetitive, like a motif, like Beethoven, right? And so with that, I'm learning that this is a world I really enjoy. I'm quite good at it, and it's something that I'm going to continue to do. So what we're doing today is we're actually putting together this season. So I should say like this next few weeks, I'm actually putting together several trailer tracks for different things. And they're all in different styles, but more or less, I'm writing in either an uplifting, like family-friendly adventure. So think Disney, think Pixar, think... what's another good example? I don't know, just like family movies, like either like sci-fi family movies that introduce space or introduce like larger than life concepts and characters and fantasy. Or I'm doing the exact opposite, which is like, think Batman, like Marvel superheroes, DC Comics, Warner Brothers, anything that's like really dark and gritty, suspenseful, not quite horror, but either way, both of those genres have this massive size to them and a massive scope. So with that, because I'm getting more into trailers, this is a skill I need to work on, and it's a skill it's highly monetizable. There's a lot of ways to make an income through this type of music in the same way that we do with game music packs. And at the end of the day, if these tracks are not used in movie trailers and game trailers, etc., these can also be turned into a game music pack. So there's so many avenues that this can go down. This could also be YouTube streamed music. This could be Spotify streamed, etc. So there's so many ways to monetize what we do. And it doesn't have to fit in this perfect little box called game music, right? Video game music. So part of what we want to teach you in Video Game Music Alliance are there's a lot of ways to make a living with video game music. It doesn't have to be just custom music for a game. So that's what we're going to explore today. I'm really excited. And again, what we're doing is we're looking specifically at one library that I'll be using among others, which is the Hans Zimmer Percussion. As part of getting more into this world, I've been specifically talking to trailer composers, people who are doing this for a living. And there's a certain set of libraries that they tend to use because they're like the staples of the sounds that we've come to expect. And so what I want to do is at the top of this stream, is let's open up Kontakt. I'm currently using Kontakt 7, and this is the Hans Zimmer Percussion Library. And the first thing you'll notice, it is very, very simple. In fact, there's two patches. There's the percussion and there's timpani. And then we have these folders of presets. I like that they created a low CPU version for anyone that's like struggling on RAM. And then they have just a normal presets folder. So all of these libraries here are all actually combined together in this one patch right here. And I was smart and I installed it on one of my SSDs. In fact, it's not even an SSD. It's a, what do they call it? I've already forgotten the name of it. I'll think of it later, but it's the little, like the motherboard chip, the M.2, that's what it's called. So I recently upgraded to an M.2 drive, which it's an internal SSD, but it's like the size of a thumb drive. And this little chip is something like 10 times faster than an internal SSD. It's insane. So what I do, and it's only 2 terabytes, I think. So I put all of my really large libraries, whether they're Kontakt, VSL, whatever. Like I put anything that I know is like a workhorse library and I put it on that drive. That way, I mean, you saw how fast that thing loaded. And this is a 20 gigabyte library. It's kind of insane. And this one particular patch is 1.17 gigabytes. So, but it never bogs down my system at all. So, oh, you can't hear that yet. I have to push the magic button. So just check this out. I mean, this is just me goofing around. It's so much fun. I'll mute my mic so you can actually hear it. All right, there you go. So what I love about this, it's structured almost identically if you've also played with any of the Tom Holkenberg, either the brass or the percussion libraries. That's something that Orchestral Tools has put together. By the way, Junkie XL, which is Tom Holkenberg, he and Hans Zimmer have worked a ton together on recent projects. So it's actually really cool that they think in a similar way. And what I love about this interface, as simple as it is, I love simplicity. It's like, give me one patch that's phenomenal and is easy to navigate and is color-coded, as you can see here. You can see how color-coded it is on the bottom with all the key switches. They're not key switches, but they're color-coded by the instrument that you're playing. And of course, you have your round robins. I can just literally play on one patch. And it's going to be fantastic, right? But what I also love is they have different pitched percussion within that family group. So right now I'm playing all these like teal green. So it's a whole ensemble. It's just so useful. And this is straight out of the box. I haven't touched a thing. So this stuff is recorded to sound like Hans Zimmer. And by the way, if you weren't aware, Hans's collaboration with Spitfire, they actually like handed him the files. This is insane to me. Like, he's so involved in everything he does. I have mad respect for Hans and everything he does in the music industry, because he's a trendsetter. He tends to always create a new sound for a film, and then the rest of the industry like copies him, essentially. I don't like people who copy people, but I like his original sound. And so one of the things he has kind of popularized is this epic giant sound, which now trailers for the last 10 years have copied his film sound into trailers, and it's become the norm. So it is what it is. But what was cool is after this project, after they recorded all of the samples, they handed them to Hans to mix himself. I don't know of any other sample library where the artists themselves actually had their hand on the files to produce the thing. I don't think for a second he programmed this in Kontakt, because they have the world's best programmers over there. But he mixed them and made sure that each of these sounds is exactly the way that he would use them in his projects. So it's very similar if you use Zebra, which is a synth engine. There's a Hans Zimmer version called the Dark Zebra. It's so cool because it's a very similar story of how he was very involved in that process. And those are the actual synths he used in The Dark Knight way back when. And so if you want to sound like that, use this same gear that the artist you're trying to imitate sounds like. And I can't tell you how often, even now in video games and in movie trailer world, how clients still ask me. Like last week, I got a client asking, hey, write a track in the style of Hans Zimmer, which is a little exhausting. He has such impact on the industry that everyone wants to sound like him, even non-related things. So what do I do as a composer? Well, I'm going to grab the tools that he uses, and then I'm going to write them in my style, because at least then the production will be at that same general quality. And then I can kind of shove it into my own direction, right? My own harmonic palette, my own melodic palette, my own additional instruments. But the goal here is when you use something like this, it's supposed to sound like Hans. And so if you know that your client wants that epic, big percussion sound, then use something like this. It's going to get you there so much faster. Because as you can see, I mean, it's just easy to play, and that's my favorite way to play with any sample library, and it's inspiring. So enough on that. If you're interested in grabbing this today, there is actually a link in the description below. It's not an affiliate link. It's not a sponsored link. It's Spitfire was very kind to give me a copy of this to use for today's stream, since I'm doing trailer music. So that's the only catch, if you will. This is a free copy, and so in exchange for giving an honest review of it. So far, so good. I really enjoy it. And I think this is going to become a staple of my trailer percussion sound, because it's very big and epic, and I love that style. But grab that today if you wish. It's actually 40% off. And to the best of my knowledge, Spitfire is not known to give discounts. So it's 40% off. I don't know how long that's going to last, but it's part of their spring sale. So if this is something you're interested in, check it out. And also, it's kind of a sidebar. If you want something similar to this, I would also encourage you. I'm going to grab the sign player real quick. I'm really big into orchestral tools stuff as well. If you guys remember, I did a review about a year ago, maybe like 8 months ago, something like that, on Tom Holkenberg's percussion. It's a very similar pack. And the biggest difference is Hans Zimmer's style is like big and bombastic and bigger than life. Tom Holkenberg's is actually also known as Junkie XL. His, they're almost the same instruments, funny enough. Like it's surdos and like dudebecks and it's like world percussion ensembles. But the biggest difference is when you grab something like this, visually it's not beautiful at all, but it sounds good. It's very limited. It's a very specific bass drum, surdo, two-pan toms sound, right? So it's also very dry by comparison versus the Hans Zimmer percussion is much more wider in its frequency. So what I mean by that is when you play Hans Zimmer, you're going to get your high frequencies way up here in the top of the keyboard. Cymbals, marching drums, snares, that kind of thing. But at the bottom of the keyboard, oh my gosh, I could write a whole trailer on that. It's so cool. I guess the real challenge is what happens when we combine them. I guess that's when you get Batman and Superman, right? That was an old film they did together, I think. Batman versus Superman. Wasn't that Hans and Junkie XL? If that was not their first, I think one of the Spider-Mans was one of their first. But anyway. So, what I like to do is to kick this party off. I'm certainly going to use the Hans Zimmer percussion in varying degrees across these different tracks, because depending on the style of trailer you're working on, you don't really want to go overboard with percussion. Percussion is one of those things that it instantly adds incredible amounts of energy to a track, so you actually want to use it as little as possible and as late as possible in the track. It's almost like percussion shouldn't enter the track until about halfway through, which is right around the Act 2 stage. And I want to show you guys a graphic because this kind of blew my mind the other day. Let me grab it. Oh, and by the way, I forgot to mention, you know, here's the link. If you want to check this out later, the link to the Spitfire audio page, Hans Zimmer Percussion. It's just beautiful. They make beautiful things that always sound good. And I particularly like their walkthroughs and such on the page. Good stuff. But you guys can do that kind of research on your own just fine. I want to show you a PDF that I recently came across, which I just think is brilliant. It's from the Trailer Music School, which is led by Richard Prynne. And this is his doc that he shares with his students. Just in case you guys have ever wondered, what is the structure of a trailer? And this is true of game trailers, of movie trailers, of like advertising, whatever. It's all the same. The perfect trailer cue. Say what you want about that title, but it's it's pretty accurate. Essentially, this whole graph, I just love how it's a complicated subject that is simplified in this one picture. So basically, he's saying length in seconds. So I like that he doesn't actually give a length as far as like 60 seconds, 130, you know, 2 minutes, 3 minutes. The average movie trailer is 3 minutes in length. So if right here, this is the 3 minute mark, then you're going to kind of expand each of these acts to match those time codes. But if this is a 60-second trailer, then you're going to have to move way quicker. That means that this act one is only going to last like 5 seconds, 10 seconds, 20 seconds, 5 seconds, right? You need to apply it to the actual length of what you're working on. But I just think this is so brilliantly done because essentially it's giving us the complete structure of intensity levels. I talk about that a lot in video game music because I think it's key, right? It's all about matching the intensity that's needed. So in trailer world, you always want to start at zero, like volume level, intensity level zero. And then at the end of act one, you're really not getting any bigger than like, if we're talking 1 through 10, you're not getting any bigger than like a 3. And then notice this little break here. There's like actual silence so that the music editor can cut it up later. You want at least one bar of silence or at least a few beats of silence. And then boom, act two starts. And notice you don't go back to zero, nor do you start at like 3. It's more like a 2. So then we go 2 all the way up to say 5. And by this point, we haven't even really done a big melody yet. You may have introduced it around act 2. It's more like a fragment of a melody. And then we have another break. And then boom, act 3 is really where you think the climax is. And this is one of the tricks you want to give to a listener. You want act 3 to feel like, oh man, this is the biggest, most epic thing I've ever heard in my life. So this is around a 7 or an 8 in intensity. So maybe you start at a 6 and go all the way up to an 8. But really the most like significant part of the whole trailer is right here. We take a small break and then act 4 is the most important part. It's the shortest part, but it's also a 10 out of 10 in intensity level. This is where you literally have the full blast choir. The trumpets are blaring, lots of synth layers, lots of percussion. This is where you literally are playing with every instrument that you've introduced in the entire thing. And then boom, complete silence and the track is over. And maybe you might want to sneak in a little 5 second outro for a title card. But essentially what you've done is you've created multiple cut points. And so where does percussion fit into this? Percussion is usually going to live somewhere around here. You might introduce a little bit in act two, but really act three is where it's going to shine. And then act four is where it goes full ham. So this cheat sheet is incredible because it allows you to throw your music against this structure to see if it follows. And it works every time. So this is one of those things that once you know the formula, you can start to expect it a whole lot more. So again, this is by Richard Prynne. And he's a really great educator. He runs the Trailer Music School. If you have any interest in this, we don't cover this in Video Game Music Alliance by any means, but just to kind of show you the other side of things, that'd be a great resource. So anyway, that is more or less what I'm doing today is I'm trying to showcase that style. Which, funny enough, you can kind of write a trailer in any genre. It could be rock, blues, jazz, chiptune, I don't know, it could be anything, right? But the cool thing is, as long as you follow that structure systematically, you're good to go. So I have 3 trailer tracks that I'm currently working on. If I get bored today, or if I just kind of lose motivation and inspiration, I might switch over to a different track. But my goal is to at least show 1 track today, maybe 2, just kind of depends on how this goes. But I wanted to very briefly show you my Cubase session of how I'm in 4/4 time, BPM is 64. And I've essentially just created a slow start. And act one usually starts around 20 seconds for a 3-minute track. And I intentionally try to create a rhythmic pulse that is constantly elevating. So the beginning is like whole notes. And then right here, act one, I do eighth notes. Act two, I'm doing eighth note triplets. Act two, over here, it's just more and more energy, more fullness. And then act three, I'm calling it an 8 out of 10 in energy. I'm now doing 16th notes. And then just when you think it's over, triple it, big rest. And then whoosh, poof, and then this out of nowhere extra spike to 10 out of 10, which out of nowhere, I change it to 6/4. And I'm doing my best to hover on the 1 chord of the key. So the entire track is in basically an F chord, which is a 4. So we're in the key of C major. It's an F chord, which is 4, a 6 chord, which is A minor, a 5 chord, which is G. Da 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 da, over and over, over and over, over and over. And then finally, act 4. One chord, lots and lots and lots and one chords, and it creates this like blow your face off level of intensity. And then boom, we get to this like 2-bar rest of silence, let all that reverb wash over us, and then boom, title card, which is this beautiful little piano. So with all of that, I'm not done. I'm like 60%, 70% done with this. I've only worked on it for a couple of days so far, but I wanted to at least start today with something that already has some material, and we'll go from there. So I want to see how the Hans Zimmer percussion can find its home in here, and we'll see how that goes. I want to keep this very organic and natural. And the final thing I'll say is something I've recently learned more and more is in trailer music, it's really important, just like a soundtrack. You want to have one signature sound that makes the track instantly identifiable. If you want to have any hope of it landing on a major IP, it has to have a signature sound. Otherwise, you will sound like every other trailer track in existence. This goes for games, game trailers as well. You want your game trailer to sound like the game you're writing for. So whatever your interesting signature sound was or sound design thing for the game, maybe it's a new instrument you created or a unique synth sound or something, that becomes the identity piece. So in this track, I created what I'm calling the aqua synth. Sounds like this. Very unique. And it also creates a really cool ping sound at various times, kind of like sonar. And so I ended up using that quite a bit as the melody line. There we go. So, last little thing here, and then we'll actually start working on music. Last little thing is, just for fun, just to have a visual reference, I created this sucker in Midjourney, which is an AI art generator, which you type in descriptions and you can edit it until it's what you like. And I just thought this was such a fun picture to use that we'll kind of use it across these trailer tracks. It just kind of creates the grand scale of what I'm trying to represent here today. So without further ado, I'm going to take me off screen. Let's play what we have so far. It's incomplete, but I just wanted to show you where I'm at so far and how I took this little idea, little piano line, very simple. Right? And how that turns into this. Right? That's like a 1 to a 10. So how the heck do we get there? Well, let's find out together. Here we go. Let's play. Enjoy. See you in a few.
Thank you.
All right, so that's where we are so far. Again, that's a couple of days of work trying to just get the format on paper, so to speak. And now we get to have some fun with actually producing it out to the level I want it to be. So this is the thing. This type of work, it's highly, highly specific. And thank you. Thank you very much, Jordan. I appreciate that. This is something I really want to get more into and excel at. So it's something I've been studying quite a bit. And there's something to be said about the simplicity of this little melody, right? It's such a basic, basic thing. Right? And there's something about starting on a four chord. So this is just kind of take this for your writing. If you're trying to make a story arc, don't start with a resolution, right? Don't start at the beginning, like start in the middle. Right? Something like that. And in doing so, especially if we just keep doing this, it's like our ears just know exactly what's coming every time. But if we start hanging on the five chord, and then all of a sudden, right? It elevates everything to the next level simply because of the chords I chose, right? I know, right? What would you say? 4, 5, 3, 6. Oh, I know. I mean, they are just tried and true chord progressions for a reason. In pop music, if you've ever studied it, usually starts on a four chord in the verse, and the chorus tends to be on a one. And the reason behind that is the chorus needs to feel like the most important part. So in this structure, it's that act three, act four, if you want to call it that, that it has to have the most emotional grit to it. So that's, and what's funny is this whole thing is in a major key, right? This is all happy music, uplifting music, but it's amazing how something so simple can work. So let's play through. Yeah. What is it? That'd be a fun trailer track. We could do that. Why not? It's going to take some effort. Some way too much effort is about to be put into this. But it's worth it just for you. Because, you know. The whole system crashes. Do it. The system doesn't allow it. Oh well. I wonder if, because I'm running in 32-bit float, I wonder if that is what is causing all the issues. Let's see how easy that would be to change. Just go to 24-bit. Hope it doesn't like screw up my headroom, but it is what it is. That might help. Anyway. Let's get to work, yeah? First things first, I mean, we're here to do Hans Zimmer percussion, so. Let's first isolate where the percussion is in this track and start playing around a little bit. It's all in the bottom of my session, so I'm gonna take myself off the screen just so we can see a little bit more. All right, so far so good. I like that much. I like those sticks. turn it down though. I think that's a really good stick. And these are in triplets, by the way, eighth note triplets. Just add some higher frequency. And by the way, my trailer perk, I finally just went ahead and made a stinking contact patch because it was just so much work. I took my four favorite perk patches, which was a combo of Metropolis Arc, Copernicus perk, which are like low thuds. And I mixed that with three Action Strikes ensembles, which is Taiko ensemble, mid Toms ensemble, and one other. I think it was just like a large drum ensemble. But I took all those and EQ'd them the way I like them, which I've been using a lot in recent trailers. So I just went ahead and made my own one patch, which sounds fantastic all the time now. I'm not a brilliant contact coder, but I was able to create four round robins with like nine different velocity layers. So it sounds very good. I'm very happy with it. And I also made my own sub hit just to kind of simplify my process. It's pretty good. So I don't know if I want to double everything. But that's a good sound. I don't want to go overboard, but which is easy to do with this kind of stuff. So that's a G. Yeah. So I'm thinking I might wait to pull out the sticks until Act 3 here. Because that might be the best place to do it, to give even more intensity here. That's such a good sound. Go. I might just do something completely different for that section, but I really like doubling. Shikata-dakata. But you can see how just even having some low drums already, stacking these on top. These should be 16th notes, not 8th notes. So let's double check all that. Taiko drums are the drums of percussion, of trailers, for sure. They're not the only ones. All right, these are eighth notes. I like that change of pace in the middle of it. Let's play with velocity. Make sure it's still audible. Triplet. Got triplets and spades today. Cool. Let's see how that feels, even just with that.
Thank you.
So copy all of that into whatever they have for snare ensemble. Zimmer line. That feels so good. I'll try to play it in. Never overemphasize how important little ramps like this are in velocity. If you're just stuck on the highest velocity at all times, just whack, 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 man, it's boring. So it's nice to have these little ramps. Gives so much dynamic contrast. It's great. Cool. I'm liking that so far. I have to fill out some more of this as we go. First things, foist. Where I feel like this track is currently lacking a bit is act two, act three. I'm just like missing stuff. Just missing layers and let me just kind of jump in around act two. I don't like doing the sticks yet. It's too soon. Thank you. synth pad. So another common thing to do in trailer music is to cut off a phrase in the middle of it in acts one and two. Don't ever complete a phrase because you want to interrupt it. These are fragments. That definitely needs some kind of transition. Right? We need like a swish hit. That's what they're really called. Swish hits or whooshes or whatever. Swish. Can't be too big. Cool. So a rule of thumb I have whenever I'm working with MIDI phrases is I always bounce it in place. Oh, I can actually work with the real audio and not just what I think the MIDI is going to do. I already have an ongoing whooshes. Thing. Track. And so I'll just kind of line it up exactly where I want it. And that way I can control the fades to my liking. I can go up and down. Line it up better. One trick I've learned is just to punch it in and let it loop. Cymbal, that'll be nice to give some higher frequencies. Same thing, let's just punch it in, find the exact spot. Metroid Prime, cool. Trying to put a little bit of reverb on this. Hits. A little dry. There we go. Cool. And just for safekeeping, we put an EQ on them. Just make sure we're not bleeding into that lower end, especially with a reverb on it. That's cool. I really like those sticks. So without going all the way into like 10 out of 10 intensity level, I still feel like the high register can use something, and it can't be choir because that is just, it's too much, but some kind of high synth-y might be good. That's what we're currently working with. That sounds good. And I'm kind of trying to keep it spacey, sci-fi. That's gonna sound cool. And I'll ride the mod wheels so that it fits. Yeah. Oh, that sounds so much better. It's so full now without being over the top, because the percussion's not over the top. I don't even have a low brass line in yet. I don't have a low sub bass yet, and I don't have a choir. I don't have, so all the things that make it a 10 out of 10, I'm able to accomplish with just adding another layer of synth here. So yay. I want to be careful that even though it's a synth, I still want breath. Even though it's like imaginary breath in the line. So whatever the brass would do, which in the case of French horns, they're gonna go yada breath, da da, and the trombones obviously. Wait, so, and by the way, I learned yesterday that when I doubled the horn line with trombones, it just makes it so much more powerful. Because originally it was just this, it was the horns. Great, but it doesn't cut through as much as if I do it with the trombones. Here's the trombones. And then together. That's so nice. Woof. Especially with the synths. So here we go. Yeah, that feels so good. And then that big one chord. Delicious. All right, so. So this synth is actually just part of my template from past trailer music. I'll show you where it came from. Just a second. I like that a lot. And these are all quarter notes, I think. I don't want those to glide. I have to be careful on where I'm putting the brakes. Ah, that's a good place for a glide. But I want to make sure that I use my velocity for maximum impact. Which is probably just going to come through the mod wheel instead of velocity. So here. So I'm going to do this right here where it's like 80% of the growth happens here. And then there. Let's make it more extreme. Yeah. Cool. We'll be right back. power of the one chord. But really, it's more than the one chord. It's actually the use of the two chord, which I've been listening to a lot of trailer music recently, and the two chord, the minor two chord in a major key, so a D minor in the scale of C major, if you use it tastefully and save it for the end, it just has this like super dramatic feeling. Because it's like we establish the one, two, now we have to go somewhere, 6-4, and it makes us want to go to the one to end it. So it's just a good way of like putting an exclamation point at the end. Anyway, I wanted to show you. Yeah, okay. So this is actually a Hans Zimmer thing too. So Zebra, this is the Dark Zebra. This is the patch Blade, High Hard. So if that matters to you. But then I also took that patch and I threw RC20, which is retro color. This has got to be my favorite plugin purchase in years. It instantly takes a digital synth and it makes it sound like it's analog. Because it adds noise, it adds wobble to the pitch, it adds some distortion if you want it, some space, which is reverb, and magnetism, whatever that means. I think it's just kind of like the grit of the sound. It makes it sound like vinyl. I just use it in very small percentages, but man, does it make a difference. For example, I mean, just check out this line. I'll play the line we just did. If I can find it. It's all the way over here in Act 3. Okay, so this thing without retro color. Pretty cool, right? But with all the fun little effects. It adds all those just a little bit. Some wobble and some like tube distortion. It's subtle, but it adds just enough grit that when you start to do this on all of your synths, it creates this beautiful, just yumminess. Anyway, another secret weapon I have today that helps to make that end so freakishly full, it's distortion on my brass. I didn't do it on my brass this time. I put it on my sub bass, my synth bass. So right here. The reason this sounds so thick is because I'm doing the low strings. Actually, I don't even have low strings on this. How funny. I should. So this sound. It's already a very thick bass. With distortion on it, but then you add a sub bass another octave lower. Yeah. So really the power is coming from synths, not from the brass, but when you double that with the brass down here, tell that now that I've soloed those, these trombones and brass, low brass like tubas and cimbazzi are all like two. Need to be more delayed. What do you call this? Delay compensation. They need to go further back. What's up, Sarah? Marie, you're good. I sang a C, I think. When I was doing my one chord, I sang a C. It's in C, that's the whole point. C, so C, D, A, F. I have relative pitch. So once I've established the key of something, I can find the pitch very easily. But just out of thin air, if I'm just trying to like, oh, that car crash was in the key of E flat. I mean, no. Thank you. What's funny is I never even bothered to put the low strings in, but I should. Ooh, that's so satisfying. A low C. I know, I couldn't have said microwave, sound of an alarm. Nope, went straight for the car crash. All right, so. Ah, redo. There we go. Redo, and then boom. I'm going to make all of these triplets. And then, specifically, I'm going to move any of those fast notes. What did I just do? What is this mode that I've entered? Ah! Kind of editing mode that I don't like. Ugh. It's like Pro Tools, like going into a different... Gross. What happened? Like a whole menu. Cubase is just has so many features. I don't even know what all of them do. The heck? I don't like you right now. Help. I've never seen this menu. Undo? Undo does nothing. Just makes it worse. That's like little clips. What is this? Egads. Controller lane setup. I don't want a controller lane. Show velocity lane only. Nope. Doesn't like that. What is happening? Where's Andrew when I need him? He's my Cubase expert in our group. I'm absolutely lost. And I can't undo it. But it's like this perpetual thing. I'm so lost. That's what I get. Oh, it's back. Nope, kinda. What's happening? How do I get out of this? Oh, okay. It's that thing. It's that triangle. That's dumb. And it's literally called static toolbar. No, dumb. Bad decision. Don't do that. What a terrible, terrible fate. I'm sorry that the rest of the stream is now dedicated to solving this. This is new for me. Not okay with this happening. Just leave me alone. Oh, I fixed it. Goodness gracious, that was bad. That was bad. Okay. I don't know how I caused it, and I certainly don't know how I fixed it, but I'm just going to move on with my life because that was scary. I felt taken advantage of. All right. Hey, welcome, Walt. Do you happen to know the other Walt? I know he's passed away, but... This track might work in one of his movies. All right. Anyway. No. All right. So here's all I wanted to do is I wanted to take this, shove it into the low strings, specifically for the triplet notes. Yun dun dun, like that, and then do the same thing here, just inverse. I'll I'll do one of these shankatatakatas. Technical term. Copyright 2023. Shankatatakata. See that? Nine times fast. Shankatatakata!
Excellent.
All right, that felt good. I'm glad I added the strings. I was missing earlier. It looks like... Yeah, this rise is not doing it for me. I'm going to need a new riser. There's plenty of places to find such a thing. Let me open up Trailer Expressions, which is a sample logic library. And they have some things, I think, some risers. Yeah, rises. Let's start there. I don't want anything that's like horror. Really just want something basic. That's pretty cool. Try that. All right, so it's really long, so I'll pump it in way back here. All right, so these are my rises. I've mentioned before, I like to just convert to audio anything that's a loop or a phrase. That way I can just chop it up however I need. So this guy here, let's call it end rise. And it needs to end right here with a little bit of reverb, because I'm trying to line up that waveform with the end there. It's a big old rise, so I want to give it probably 2 bars of a fade in. Let it do its thing, turn it down a little bit. Ooh, that felt good. Off. And I'm going to transpose it by just a half step. Just that single audio file. Wherever it ended up. Oh my heavens. There. Because you in Cubase, you can do this instant transpose with audio, which is incredible. Perfect. There. So 83.3. Doesn't feel right yet. It's a little soon. There it is. Okay. And then get all that off of there. See how it feels in context. Save. Thank you. good to me. Okay. Let's kind of feel this out from the top. See where we're at. I chose in the background here to have a gravity patch that is like a fifth, or it's a five chord, which means it doesn't, it's not major or minor. It's just kind of establishing the key. It doesn't change, it just kind of hovers there. To my ears, it's it needs a B2. Like, it needs more space. Let's try like 40% size and then like 5 seconds. Yeah. Oh, that feels like outer space or underwater, whatever the context is. I'd like to be under the sea in an octopus's garden in the shade. Boom, 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 boom. You're welcome. All right, so free Beatles concert just for you. We are living a yellow submarine, a yellow submarine, a yellow submarine. Yum. Wow, Marie, that was dark. Very, very dark. What I was going to do is I wanted to get this pad into... I wanted to get into this audio channel instead of... floating around in that land. That way I can play with it a little bit. Here, I wanna hear it. This needs something right here. We need like transition. Let me feel this out. I like the timing of it. Might just be as simple as it needs. It doesn't need percussion. It just needs a whoosh. Cool. But let's get this out of the way. So a good rule of thumb is to try to keep your staccato strings out of the arrangement until you absolutely have to have them. And you do have to have them around act two-ish to three, especially three. So I'm wondering if I just bring them in on like 2B, I'm calling this act 2B, so 2A, I like the triplet motion. I'm wondering if I can get away with it if I disable the strings and just do synth. Would that work? So we came out of this. So we have the aqua synth doing its yabba da bum. I like it without it. Here's what I'll do. To make the second half. Maybe here. I don't know, I like it. Yeah, and then. Especially if we're going to make this synth a big part of it, it means I need to lean into synths sooner. And just make it a little bit more fuller. And notice I introduced the brass here. Slowly. Just like little swells. Helps get them in. Sneak them in. So here, let's play with this synth. So I'm gonna play around with this guy. Do some filter sweeping. Right here. Start doubling some things. So this needs to be doubled, which is the high strings, which came from the synth. So it just means I need to really taper this to be more, I don't know, interesting. Same ride. I'm also going to make these way shorter. So they're currently eighth notes. Let's make them six. Oh, no, they're eighth note triplets. So let's just make them shorter. The stereo delay can really do its job. Yeah. Something. Serve the moment. I'm wondering if this is too high. This part. Should this be an octave lower? This just came out of this. Yeah. Okay, that, but just an octave lower. Symbol. So, this part, I have too many crashes, but I do like the concept of like really ramping it up, making this feel fuller. That part's cool. that takes it more from an 8 to a 10 instead of like a 5 to a 10, which we need. So I need to write a new, this whole thing is jacked up, so I need to redo the synth here. The automation. This stuff matters. It's like all the parts have to work together to create this beautiful sum. So let's do this. To read this fab filter EQ so this thing can really breathe. All screwed up. All right, there we go. Okay, how about now? Any audio because the filters are not up.
Oh,
frustration ensues. There it is. All right, so I need to ride that knob right there. Here we go. I'll do that while soloing high lead, because that's the biggest conflict range. Here. There it is. All right, so the same treatment for the mid synth arp down here. There's lots of automation that needs some loving. So for that one, that was the Juno. That was the Juno emulation from Arturia, I believe. Sounds so good. So faithful to the original. For this next piece, I'm going to grab this guy. Fab filter. I'm just going to write it here. Some automation in here. Mix that with the synth bass. We'll be right back. Let's tame these strings. I want them to do that wave at the end. Copyright this moment. All right, friends, let's take a quick coffee break. Don't go anywhere. Thank you. Friends, welcome back. Wow, you guys are really stuck on this E-flat car crash nonsense, aren't you? Have to be more careful about the things I say, apparently. Gee willikers. Well, friends, I hope you're having fun today. It's so good to be back. It's so good to be just riding and hanging out with you guys. As you can see, I'm very much in the zone today and having a blast. And it's been fun to throw and to find a spot for Hans Zimmer Percussion from Spitfire Audio inside this trailer track. I want to be done with this in the next few minutes and switch over to a different trailer track just to kind of give a different inspiration, different creativity. I find for me, when I'm writing music, I like to focus really hard for about 2 hours. And then I find that my creativity starts to dwindle. And so it's good for me to just switch to something else that's very different. I think that's a healthy thing. By the way, it got like ridiculously hot over here in Atlanta, Georgia. It's crazy. Spring days, they start really cold. And so we wear a bunch of layers. And then by the like mid-afternoon like this, it just gets like crazy hot and humid. So we have to like shed all the layers. Anyway, let's have some fun. Let's continue this process. I'd like to go back to the top here. And this is just part of it. It's going back and listening to what you've done. Make sure it all fits.
Thank you.
I don't like this note. Let's experiment with what would happen if we ramp up this section, this Act 3. Right now it feels like one giant, like, level 7 intensity or 8. But what I want it to go do is go from 6 to 8. So I feel like I have too much happening at the top. So it might even just be as simple as muting the high strings. So this is where overriding can get us in trouble, but it's good to just pull something back sometimes. So let me see what happens when 65 tends to be there. Let's see what it feels like to do a little bit less. Hold up a second. I have the solution. I like that because all of a sudden the top end isn't quite there yet, but we're expecting it. This is where the choir needs to come in. It needs to just follow the melody because it's going to give just enough epic. And we're close enough to the end. We're at the 2-minute mark. We're close enough to the end that it can handle it now. Sounds so bad isolated, but sounds dumb, but in context, it works. Flippin' crackles. It doesn't do that when I'm not streaming, but I don't know what else to do. Oh well. Alas. So all of that is quarter notes. This is eighth note triplets. This is what I get for trying to show you my process. Oh well. Cool. That's a really good addition. it's really, really good. I like that choir edition that adds so much. I wish we could, I could stream it without all the cracks and pops, but whatever. Ah, okay, so this is where the synth. Maybe I just need to cut that out too. Until the second half. Forgot to do piano the second half. That'll help too. From that, that's 10. This should be about 5, act 2. Should really be a 3 here to a 5. Yeah, it's about a 3. And it lets us enjoy the strings. Oh, interesting. I don't have any strings there. Oh, I could, that's what a lost opportunity. Thoughts on me moving. Maybe that's what I should do. Maybe I should move this. You can't see what I'm doing. Maybe I should move these strings arrangement-wise to here. That way they feel larger than before. Because at the beginning, it may have been too much. Right? Piano and synth. Change one note and it'll be ready. Yay! That was a good arrangement switch. Na, da, da, G, A. Yeah, that was a win. Cool. Sometimes you just gotta listen to it a million times till you can like hear that stuff. Cutting off that phrase like that. It makes it feel really good to then jump into the next section. All right, friends, don't go anywhere. I'm happy with that for today. I'm going to give that another day or so of just really getting that production to where it needs to be. I'm like 90-95% happy with it. I think what it's going to take is listening on my studio monitors and really getting the mix right and kind of feeling out, okay, are there any instruments that feel like they're missing? Are there any doublings or layerings that are getting muddy? I'll probably like individually go through each line one more time just to kind of clean it up and make sure it's really working as intended. Because in this world, when it comes to production quality, it has to be absolutely top-notch, absolutely clean. And that's where you start cleaning that stuff up. And it's never good for me to try to do that on the same day that I write the thing. So I like to always take one day break, come back. So don't go anywhere. We're going to take a very short coffee break, just long enough for me to switch over to a different session, very different style. Let's go to like the Batman style, something very dark and gritty, much more on the dark side, okay? So don't go anywhere. Be right back in just a minute. Welcome back. Let's do some more trailer music. So, I have a little bit of time left, so let's switch over to a very different style of trailer track. Rocking some Hans Zimmer Percussion. So if you'd like to join Video Game Music Alliance, come join us. Waitlist plus free guide right now. Shabam, bam, 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 bam. VideoGameMusicAlliance.mn.co or just go to VideoGameMusicAlliance.com, whichever your heart desires. And today we're featuring Hans Zimmer Percussion by Spitfire Audio. Use the link in the description for 40% off during the spring sale. I think that goes for all things Spitfire, if I'm not mistaken. All right, number two, track number two. This one's brand spanking new. As I was mentioning earlier at the beginning of the stream, if you were here, I talked a little bit about the, whatever you call it, the structure of a trailer track and how it's important to have an identifiable, unique signature sound and then base the entire cue off of that one sound and then build from it. Start from one, go all the way up to 10. And so sometimes it doesn't have to be melodic. It can be like a weird screechy sound or something. Other times you can find it in between where it is melodic, but you're constantly evolving that little motif, and that's what I want to do here today.
a fun patch. All right.
Anyway, I'm Batman.
So here's what I have so far. This actually would work in Batman. Here's my little thing. That's all I have so far. So, I really want to use this little motive. It has like a sinister edge. And you could just do so much with this. You can use like a felt piano. Softer moments, and then you can really go right and just go ham with it, but it's still, there's still not a signature sound. So I was just playing around with Massive, came up with a screechy sound. I don't know if this is what I want to go with yet. Right, so that doesn't really fit trailer vibes just yet, but the way to structure this is to still, if that's like a medium, if that's a 5 out of 10 intensity level, it's good to introduce the idea. So many cool things we could do with this. This is the fun. Sometimes we can just experiment, play around. So time code wise, I have to really be cognizant of that. So let's pretend like this is the big thing. So right here at 2 minutes, I'm gonna create act 3. Let's see where it happens. So five, four is not gonna fly in a trailer. So maybe like ding 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 ding. Like really, really harp on the sharp 7. You can get pretty interesting in trailers. The good trailers are interesting. They're not cliche. But you have to establish some kind of center, some focus. But I like that 4-4. Ticka, 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 ticka. So for me, I need a different instrument to really feel this out. Let's do piano, it's fine. So I'll start with C minor. It kind of depends on what mood we're trying to go for. This is the most important part. Kind of get that out of the way. Da, 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 da. It's gonna be quick too. We'll play with the tempo. Gotta think of your fastest moment in the whole thing. So I'm thinking of like the strings just wailing. Tempo for that madness and base everything else around it. So I think we need to just double the tempo, 160, make it 150. It's amazing how everything kind of gravitates back to around 120 BPM because it's like it's the perfect tempo that can be halved and doubled or triplets. Let's play with that. One, two, and. Triple it. So you guys are getting to watch the very beginnings of a track. Shabba-da-da-ba-dub. Shabba-da-da-ba-dub. Everything else is 16ths. Gotta start with some kind of idea. Just run with it. It's a great starting point. So with that, take it, right? Love having that high C up there. Just everything is a one or a seven. The seven being the five chord. The seventh pitch, the sharp seven, which is a B natural in the key of C minor. Yeah, da 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 da. Eighth note, keeping pulse. Shabba da da ba da. Shabba da. Someone typed it. Shabba da da ba da. Triple it. So far, so good. I'm just trying to create like a large moment, and then we can deconstruct from there. So. double that in the synth for sure. Automation that I didn't know about. I'm not going to copy Danny Elfman, but, you know, if you had to copy somebody, he'd be a good one. Dark. Love it. Especially add this bad boy here. Big, that way I can deconstruct it later. So great. I love it. That Cool. Cool. Cool possibilities here. So we're in this tempo. Let's try a new piano here. A super bright piano. Yes, dark, but clarity. Thank you. This stuff, it's not bad. I'm just going to kind of toss it aside. Somewhere over here, if I ever want to come back to it, I can. But for now, we're now stuck in this new tempo. That could be a cue, right? But a unique sound. Oof. Let's go. I need simple. This whole thing is based around this. Right? Like that. Come on, that's like trailers 101. We'll call that Act 1 synth bass pulse. Point, just lots of ideas there. Everything until here is eighth note, and then these are all 16ths. Here we go. This is how I make reverse pianos. I just do a ton of reverb. Record the thing and then bounce it. And then I have a key command that reverses it. Just like that. I color code it. Put it exactly where I want it. Right about there, turn it down. Oh man, my note was too short. Let me try again. It needs to be like a full. But the real problem was that I did not do the correct bounce in place. I'm supposed to copy over the info. All right, so here we go. Render in place. Render settings. I want the complete signal path. There it is, reverse. Now let's do it, and now I don't have to bother with all that nonsense. So this is reverse piano. I just want one bar. Like that, turn it down. Okay, here we go. Yeah. And then this part, yum bum bum bum, needs to have a sub hit. Like that. Okay, and then this guy just needs to be tamed a little bit with his mod wheel. It's a little too low. There we are. We're ready. Woohoo! Two, ready. Yeah, that's gonna be fun. Okay, so let's play with this a little bit. This needs some help. This needs to be B2'd, which is this guy right here. Up. Here we go. Let's have some fun. One, two, ready. But it's not enough to just do the reverb thing. I also want to pitch bend it. And then hit that super hard in your face. And that's, I want that to be the thing. Yeah, but da 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 da, because I'm already using that in the strings later. That thing. So let's, instead of, we'll just do four notes. It's simpler and it works. And we can blast people's faces off. Maybe. Thank you. Trying to create some kind of sonic interest that's unique. Like that, so this can be a like a 6/4 bar. We're going, guys. We're ready. Let's make some stuff. So right here. Right. So this is where the strings come in, because you always want to wait until Act Two. Let's call this Act Two. Act Two is where the short strings come in. So this is, if you're watching, let's say a DC Comics, you know, we're kind of picking on Batman. This is where the logo comes in, where it says Warner Brothers or it says DC Comics or whatever. It's usually right around this spot, anywhere in the 20 to 40 second range. And it's usually right when the strings come in. You can just see that. Right. We definitely need to hang out on that chord. Hold on, let me stop a timer here. My phone. All right, there we go. So, we gotta have one of those. So that's probably a little bit more superhero-y. Just solo that. Thank you. triplets don't work in this style, so. There's a new really powerful accented eighth note riff. This is like always a tricky part. It's trying to find a rhythm that can work in both. So we have to keep going back to the full. Those are triplets. It gives it a nice like chuggy feel. Again, these are just ideas, and I have to really workshop these, but. About that doesn't feel right. It's like triplets don't fit that vibe. I like that a lot. I can use both. This would actually make a great act four. Let me do this. These are both usable. So let me scrub this all the way back to like right around like 230 mark. This would make a great act four, which is like a new theme out of nowhere. To call back to that original idea. That way, three can be right here. 65. I like that. I guess I could use some tremolos. So to my head is this. Clear until right there. That way everything stays eighth notes. Dun 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 dun. And then the most epic part. Yay! Now I can actually work with this. Whew. Now I know generally what we need, because we need this thing to evolve, right? So here we just need kind of like the low and mid strings. starting point. All right, about to wrap this party up. Maybe we can get something good out of this part here. Cool. All right, folks, I'm burnt out, but that's okay because we got a lot of progress done. This type of music, it just takes multiple days, sometimes a week or so, to really get into the track. Just like, as you noticed, the first track we started with today, it already had a couple days of polish on it, of just like working out the kinks and really landing on something. And today kind of made up a bunch of new stuff, so for this Batman-esque one. So I'm excited to spend more time on these. My current plan right now is next week. We do have on Thursday as part of our normal time. Instead of a live composing show, we'll be doing the a live listening party of the Zelda Tears of the Kingdom challenge, which is a challenge within our pro group. So come and check that out. We're going to be playing through our different members who participated and just kind of showcasing it next to the picture to see how everybody did and just talk about it. It's going to be a fun listening party time. So sometime next week, probably Tuesday or Wednesday, I'm going to do another one of these trailer streams. And specifically, the goal is actually feature a different sample library, a strings library, to show the more beautiful side of writing in this style, and how you can morph that beautiful, like almost string quartet sound into the big, full, uplifting side. And so that's my third track that we'll work on that time. Very much in a similar uplifting family adventure, sci-fi, fantasy kind of style, like the first track we did today, but a little bit different tune, different style. So it's going to be a lot of fun. And I hope that this was a fun, different way to do live composing today. It was certainly fun for me, and I can't wait to finish these tracks. I'm already feeling very proud of the first one. Not so much this one because it's too new. It's too unpolished, but that's the beauty of getting to work multiple days on one piece of music. You really get to refine it and turn it into something a little bit more special than just whipping a track out on one day, you know? So hope you join us for that. It'll be at the normal time, 12 o'clock Eastern time next week, either Tuesday or Wednesday. If you're not on our email list, you can join that and you'll know exactly when everything's coming. All right here, you can join the wait list, which is also our email list, and you'll get a free guide. So just kind of stay tuned. I do my best to stay public on all of our info, but sometimes it's hard to get all these events squared away soon enough. So look forward to seeing you guys then. Have a lovely day. Let's end the stream a little different. Since you are all video game nerds like me, perhaps we can just have a moment of something a little gentle. Let's trailerize that a little bit. Where are my new strings? Ah, they're hiding in the next track. Darn. That's okay. Thank you. funky.
Thank you.
Well, I broke my machine. So, with that in mind, bye. That was a...